Okay, so I'm here today with Ian, who's I've known for fuck since like what, 2008 or 9, something like that.
Something like that, yeah, it sounds right.
Yeah, we've been training together since then, and he runs our branch of RCI in Nagoya. Every time I want to film, it's right on point. And he's been here for about the same time as I am. I have been, but probably longer because I'm always back and forth, and I've been out and done different shit. So what? This would be the 12th year, wouldn't it?
Yeah, I would say. I think. I mean, at some point you kind of lose track, and it stops meaning much. You know, but probably about 12 years.
Right. And he's doing a PhD at the moment on what is it?
Organizational systems with focus. My focus is on the Japanese education system. Mm-hmm. And I have my master's in international comparative education. So I've done a lot of studying of all things Japan.
Education here, culture here, and he's encountered it himself. And last time he was here, on a few weeks ago, we were doing some training, and we were starting to talk about, it's hard to say this without coming off like an asshole, but it's, we're at a very good standpoint. We've had a lot of experience here, and we can easily say this without being discriminative or racist or whatever, but there's a lot of fucking weird people here, and there's, you're kind of dealing with a society that has been, there's a lot of like robot, like, especially just when you get hit by this sea of not only black hair, but suits, this salaryman sort of culture, which is really crazy because, in the working hours, in the daylight, generally speaking, they're very friendly, polite, and courteous and considerate and all that sort of thing, very respectful, have one or two beers and they can just be complete assholes. Now, this isn't everybody because, to be blunt here, to be honest, to be frank, most of my guys are very like-minded people, very cool, very genuine, very sweet guys, right? They're all sweet. But we're just talking about different experiences that we've had. We're at a place just across the road where I got into an altercation, and we're talking about why can people have such social retardation, right? Why are we dealing with such robot-like humans these days? And it's not just here, but we're talking about here for now. And what's the fucking score? And he gave me his opinion on it a few weeks ago based on his studies and also living here for the past 12 years. And it was a great insight, so I wanted to share this with you guys. So I'll hand it over to you.
Oh, wow. So this is such a broad topic that I don't have any confidence that I'll give you the same insight, but...
Well, we're talking about the kid that cut off the head of the parent and brought it to school, and I think that's where it started.
Yeah, so one of the most famous cases of violence, I guess you could consider asocial violence, because it's not robbery, it's something that is, like, predatory, much more so, or rather even, like a person malfunctioning, right, is the Kobe killer, who this is probably 1994, maybe? Something like that. And he was a junior elementary school? No, junior high school?
I think junior.
Yeah. School, yeah. Actually, I think it was sixth grade elementary school, maybe? Fuck, whatever. Mm-hmm. He's a young kid, right? And what he did was, he decapitated a local elementary school kid and left the kid's head on the school gate along with a note that said, if I had been the same person that I used to be, I never would have dared to do something like this, but this society and this school system have made me invisible, and now I'm doing this to be seen, to not be invisible. And obviously this is a striking case, and it rattled a bunch of people because this kid came from a good family, he had a bright future. This is like the sort of prototypical successful Japanese young person, right? But the more shocking thing, perhaps, about this whole thing is, once the details of this case came out, the radio stations, local radio stations, local news organizations were flooded with letters written by other students who were commiserating with, the Kobe killer and saying that they understood his feelings, that they often felt the same way, and this sort of tidal wave of, people who were identifying with his motivations just took the country by surprise and kind of blew away what they what they had come to expect from their education system, from their young people, and the placid sort of exterior that Luke just talked about, with sort of everybody dressed the same way and being courteous enough that everything goes smoothly. There is a seedy underbelly to it all.
It's like they're living, everyone here is like, and I even get it myself, and you do too, like, you know, having to speak Kegel, for example, like, it's very hard, and there's, you know, that whole expectation, living in such expectation. It's kind of easier for us as foreigners when you say that if we don't use Kegel, though we should a lot of the time, they just go, oh, well, at least you can fucking communicate. It's like a little kid who hasn't been through that sort of education yet, mm-hmm. but, you know, I've started in the last couple of years to use it a lot more. I've definitely become more aware of it because everyone uses it around me, but it's incredibly hard to use, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Correctly. Yeah. But anyway, my point is that, yeah, living in that expectation. But you were saying about how everyone's sort of modeled into this with the schooling, the education system, and how they've tried to change that recently, or how they're doing. What's going on with that?
Well, I think becoming an adult in Japan, one of the major... the socialization function of education here, one of its major motivations is to get people to accept increasingly complex and onerous responsibilities, right? You know, they need to use Kegel perfectly in every situation. They need to accept the obligations of being a part of a family and being part of a company being Japanese and all of the things that those mean, this whole web of responsibilities that they have to sort of learn to accept. And the more responsibilities you have, and I think this is true of adults anywhere, I've certainly found it since I, you know, had a kid and have gotten married and things like that, you know, the more responsibilities you have, the less leeway you have to sort of do as you please. Mm-hmm. And so the result, I think, for the population at large is that they have so many responsibilities that the feeling is of life is as, you know, it's becoming sort of semi, right? They use the word semi about Japan. It's a narrow country, like geographically speaking, there's not much land. But it's also semi in terms of you don't have much wiggle room socially. You know, much space, cramped, that sort of narrow and confining sort of. And so what you end up with is, in the little space that you have, there's a lot of, there's a undeniable need to sort of express yourself in some way. And this is where you see a lot of the weirdness of Japanese. It's such a weird country.
The guy we just saw just then, like filming, is like this new fashion. It's like, one, they're either trying to look like One Direction, or two, or some shit, or two, they're like, yeah. What the fuck was that? Like Willy Wonka looking fucking...
Yeah, it honestly does look like something from a chocolate factory.
Yeah, it's so common.
Rodal or whatever.
Sorry to interject.
No. I mean, that's a perfect example. Like, fashion is a perfect example. Things Harajuku fashion and, you know, people that fall in love with idols, right? Like AKB fans and stuff. Like, these are the weird eccentricities that people need to indulge in order to let out the stress that comes from having all of the responsibilities that they do.
Everyone's kind of like a maniac of something, they call it, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Like an idol maniac or a sabage maniac, and it's like, what the fuck? Well, they're an otaku for like little figurines and stuff. Like, you know, I got a relative that's 41 and he fucking collects figurines. I'm like, dude, really?
Yeah, it's rarer here, I would say, to find like well-balanced individuals who sort of have everything in its place and they've got their sort of bases covered in what you would expect an adult way to be. Mm-hmm. You know, often it's, I have work, mm-hmm. and that takes up 90% of my time and effort, and then the other 10% I spend doing something super weird that I'm all about, you know, every free moment that I have.
But don't you think it's bizarre that there's been a lot of things put out there about this. I think they've done semi-documentaries or whatever, fucking, you know, the sexless country, you know, and it's so true because our population here in Japan is supposed to be halved by 2050 or something, apparently, and that we're still going to be alive, hopefully, at that time. But I'm just saying, I think it's a social issue here that people don't know how to fucking talk to each other. They don't know how to be sociable. And that's why I, in part just before, I mentioned social retardation. They don't know how to fucking be, unless they're in a specific scenario where it's already predetermined that I'm allowed to be fucking rude and talk down to you. Like, if they've had a couple of drinks and they've paid for the girl, like Keba, I've done videos on this before, they're just treated like shit, isn't it? And it's like, no wonder you haven't got a fucking woman.
Yeah.
But they treat him like shit anyway. I'm like, what the fuck is with that? It's like, we had a situation just recently, and they call it power hata here, and I've done a thing on a Japanese channel about that, but I could kind of see one of these guys that came to a seminar was talking down to his wife, and really, the way he spoke to her was really horrible, and I just went, oh, this is fucked, this guy's a bit weird. You were there, Osaka. That guy beat the fuck out of his missus and the kid that came. Beat the fuck out of them. They just ran out of, yeah, big bad story. I won't get into it because it's none of our business, but that's what I'm saying. He seemed a little bit off, do you remember? Because he goes, like, what the fuck's this guy on about? You know, the way he spoke to his missus, made her wait outside for 3 hours and all this shit. I'm like, dude, what the fuck? You know, it's just, to us, it's a bit weird because we're a little bit more considerate in that sense, but here they're all the most considerate people. I'm like, well, yeah, when it's expected, like I was saying before, right? They're expected to be, it's like a social. You have to be polite to people you don't know, isn't it? Even if we're the same age and whatever, and we're the same level of status, if I don't know you, I have to use cable. That's the expectation, right? But what I'm getting at here is, like, people don't know how to talk to women unless it's kind of like what they call here pavahara, like being, like harassing them, like talking down to them, like treating them like shit. And women go for it, don't they? It's weird. Do you know how many women I know here, even one of the, I won't say who, the girl that was just here, hasn't had a boyfriend in like 4 or 5 years. And I know chicks that are like fucking hot and doing themselves up really well and make an effort. Fukuoka's best for that. Fukuoka's like 6 chicks to 1 dude and they're all hotties. It's fucking amazing because they're all trying to get mad. But you know, I asked one of my friends, I said, why are you with this fucking guy who's treating her like shit? You know, I've got a lot of Nigerian friends and Kenyan friends and whatever here, but this guy was Nigerian. Doesn't mean that that's anything but. Just saying, she was with him and I was like, why are you with this guy that's treating you bad? He's like slapping you around and shit, what the fuck? She goes, oh, because he liked me, he was interested in me, no one else was. My point is they don't know how to communicate, they don't know how to socialize, they don't know how to, do you know what I mean? And that's why there's that huge fucking, what do you call, industry of hostess clubs. They don't have those in Australia. They have them in the, they have one in the Gold Coast for Japanese people. I went to one in Torrance that was for Japanese people because we were drunk and stupid. He thought, what's this going to be like, you know? It was shit. But my brother walked in, she grabbed me by the dick. I'm like, yeah, you must be Chinese. Because I've never had that in my family.
Yeah, yeah.
You get that Chinese places, right? It's fucked. But yeah, anyway, my point was that, what's your take on that? The whole,
whatever. I think so much of that stems from the fact that, you know, Japan is one of the most gender role defined countries on the planet. You know, the most recent gender gap rankings that came out, I don't know, UNESCO or something like that, had Japan at like 115 out of 132 countries, something like that. It's that low. And, you know, the education for, between men and women is the same. Healthcare is the same. The other two, though, which are economic and political opportunities, women have almost none compared to most other advanced countries. The only country that's lower is South Korea, developed country, I think.
Really?
If I'm correct. I'm not entirely
sure. But there's,
sure.
There's definitely that whole, you know.
Yes.
Although they had the female prime minister who's now.
Yeah. It's a crazy situation.
Bye-bye.
But one of the sort of, I think, less immediately apparent dynamics that occurs because of this whole gender role thing is that you have a country of men who are in charge of everything, but who were all raised basically by single mothers, right? At least in terms of their home and their upbringing, right? Because their fathers are in charge of the politics and the economic success of the country, are never home, right? And so it's a country led by men, raised by women, right? And so the dynamics that you have between men and women here are the same dynamics often that you see between parents and children rather than between equals, right? And so, like, men talking down to women that they are romantically involved with, I mean, those are usually going to be men who were raised by overly indulgent mothers, you know, the kids that boss their parents or boss their mom around. On the other hand, though, you have a lot of guys who have wives that basically, you know, have their balls in a jar and, like, tell them what's what, about everything, you know. Yeah. And that's the flip side. That's a mom that was overbearing. With women, right? It's a dynamic with their father, right? A lot of fathers, sort of the traditional image of the father in Japan is the one that sort of has the hammer, right? When shit goes wrong, he shows up and lays down the law, and then the mom is the comforting presence, and that's common in a lot of cultures. But
it's true what you said before about the men never being there, because and I've talked about this on other videos about Japanese fathers, and you know, seeing this with my kids' cousins and stuff, and how their parents are. One's great, one's a fucking asshole. But they really, you know, this goes back to the whole robotic thing before about they really do. You know, and I even did this when I first got here. I tried to get a legit job and I tried to do the whole thing. It might have been just before we met. You know, having to get up at 6 a.m., be on the train for like 7 or 7.30, be at work by 8 or before. If work started at 8, you've got to be there before 8. And you might even only have like 45 minutes worth of work that day, but you've got to be there for that 8 or 10 hours or whatever the fuck it was. Yes. Till 6 p.m. basically.
Yeah.
But, and then there's meetings and there's all these other obligationary like stuff, mandatory shit that you got to do. You can't get out of, and realistically you're not home till at least 10 p.m. at night, and that's so fucking common. Like I've said this before, the bank across the road, they open at whatever a.m., like 9 a.m. or whatever, they're there an hour before, they shut at 5, but they're always there till 9 p.m. or after. You know, the lights are upstairs and they're all doing their work and then leave about 9 p.m. or after. So, you know, they're starting to call this black here, you know, the whole black, you know, there's a big thing on the news and TV about it. And they're trying to crack down on that, but that's probably what's kept the economy and people kind of strong here. You know, people work so much and they get what they're given, do you know what I mean? But if you start having to pay them more, it's like the balance sort of gets tipped in the other direction. Same with China recently, their economy going up, people not being able to afford shit, and prices here and in America and Australia starting to go up because of shit being more expensive in China. Similar thing, I think. But yeah, it's true, the expectation that people have to work so much, you know, all day, every day. I know people that get 2 days off a month. Not a week, a month.
Yeah.
So I think that stress plays a lot on it. And also the fact that most people live in a fucking apartment, like a little one, what they call 1DK or whatever.
Yeah.
Like a one room with the kitchens there and like the bathroom, toilet's a little separate thing, but it's basically one fucking room, you know?
Yeah, that's a big part of it. The responsibilities that they take on, I mean, that's really what it is. You said you have 45 minutes of work, but you're still responsible for being there all of that rest of that time. You know, it's part of what's considered being a shakaijin, you know, part of the society. And then there's also, I mean, Japanese men, more than other men, tend to view their wives as a maternal identity in their lives, right? They marry someone in order to have kids, but their wife is less a partner, less a romantic involvement, especially after the children are born, than they tend to view them as a mother, as a surrogate mother or a replacement mother for the mother that they basically gave up by becoming adults and getting married and stuff like that. And I read something recently about there's a service in Tokyo now, a couple of years ago it started, for married women who are still virgins or who almost never have sex with their husbands because their husbands won't have sex with them. Because their husbands think of them as a maternal figure, right? And that's just weird, right? Yeah. and so, you know, the husband will go get his outside, right? Go to the Kabakura, go to the health club, whatever it is.
Yeah.
And the wife is left at home with her very human needs unattended to. And so they have like basically a book full of volunteers who are volunteering to have sex with married women who can't get it elsewhere.
Yeah, I was going to say, I know heaps of married women that are banging dudes that I know, and yeah, I've met heaps of them. Because they're not getting it at home.
So, I mean, declining birth rate, what do you expect, you know?
People would find it hard to believe, but I know so many, like, friends I got here that are banging, like, two or three married women because they just want it.
Yep.
You know, and they see guys like us who are big and, you know, we work out and stuff like that, and they've got these fucking, you know, fat, bald husbands that are coming home talking to them like shit, not interested in them. What do you think they're going to do? It's like, you know, it's quite a weird dynamic, you know? Every time we go to the hub, what happens? What the fuck? Like, the hub is a British bar. They've got two here. They've got them everywhere in Japan, in most big cities anyway. And I don't like going there. I usually take people there when there's foreigners come because people speak English there, and for people who don't speak Japanese, it's just convenient. He does, obviously, but my point is that, yeah, we went there once, and straight away, it's like, every time, just chicks are just like, zoom, like that, just like straight. And we always say this, it's usually the dumb chicks that are there, do you know what I mean? Because they're not going to get treated well because they're piece of shit foreigners that are like nothing back home. Mm-hmm. Come here teaching English, don't speak the fucking language, you know, don't know anything about Japan, don't really give a fuck, and they're just there to pick up as well. So it's like, oh, it's perfect for you guys. But, you know, it's funny, man, because I know so many guys, and I've pissed people off here locally who have seen my shit and complained about it, because I've said, like, you know, I ask them, they go, what have you been up to? And I'm just like, oh, just the usual, I don't like to talk about it because sounds like I'm talking shit up or whatever, but I'm like, what do you got going on? And they're just like, oh, same shit, different day. I'm like, what were you before all this? You know, what did you have going for you when you were, you know, back home, sort of thing? Or better yet, what's your plan B? You know, what would happen to you if you lost your job, like, tomorrow because of whatever the fuck? I know a guy that was here that accidentally broke a kid's arm. He was teaching kung fu at his fucking house where he was also teaching English, and did some stupid shit and apparently broke this kid's arm and was getting sued and whatever, left the country. I'm like, what have you got? You know, used to work a bit of security, used to work at a supermarket or whatever. Now he's like 40s, and he's 40s, been here way too long, and didn't work on a plan B. And I was like, well, that's actually a very common scenario with foreigners here. Very, very common.
Very, very much so. It's a very easy country to live in. It's very easy to get comfortable, and before you know it, 10 years or whatever it has flown by, and you're exactly where you were 10 years ago.
Mm. But you're not. You've continued study. I have too. But you're how far through your PhD now? You've got like the last phase.
I'm all but dissertation. So yeah. I mean that's the biggest hurdle. But it's been 2.5 years now of that, and you know, lots of just hustling, baby. You know.
Yeah, yeah.
And I want to say before we wrap this video up, a caveat about the stuff that we've said. Mm. You know, like, not all Japanese people are anything, right? Like, it's, but generalizations have their place. You know, sociology wouldn't exist if generalizations didn't have their place. And so the biggest variation is not, you know, like, Japanese people are this and Americans are this way and Australians are this way. The biggest variation is not between populations. It's between people in populations. Mm-hmm. So you can have super awesome Japanese dudes and really weird Japanese dudes. And that's the biggest difference. It's not between the countries.
Yeah, no. If I was to do a video about weird guys in Australia, this would go for 2 to 3 hours. Because, you know, I've got so many fucking hilarious stories. But, you know, and we could do the same in any country.